pretty long.
There's some good news this week when the Premier of Victoria, John Brumby, announced the $300+ million to redevelop the Melbourne Park precinct here, and some of that will be within practice courts for the Open, but that'll also be used for the development of the game, so indoor, outdoor, hard court and clay courts. So you've been talking about it for years now, so great to see that we're going to get a facility in the centre of Melbourne that our young up-and-coming players will be able to use as a training base.
Well, the clay courts are paramount. We've needed them for years. The game has moved on to such a degree that it's the perfect tool to teach the kids how to play. And if we're going to compete internationally, we need the clay here. It's a great innovation in Melbourne. If you learn on a clay court, we have Onto Car here, which is probably the best service we have for kids up to 15 years of age to learn their craft on. But the European clay is a more advanced surface than that. These guys learn on it. And when you do, you get miles in your legs. You learn how to defend, when to attack, aerobic capacity. You keep the ball in play.
40-15.
The points are longer. You learn how to construct points. And it's really paramount, I believe, and well, it's just logic, it's fact. Paramount to develop players that can compete on an international level.
Good change up.
40-30.
From Marcus Baghdatis there, the slice backhand, just keeping it low, a lot of pace to the forehand. And that's probably the difference that will separate these two today, that Marcus has the ability to just change the play a little bit more. He's a bit more court craft, an all-court play on this surface.
Smooth, isn't he, Baghdatis? He's gaining in confidence over the last week because of the win in Sydney. He's believing now that he's a contender here. Some confidence oozing out of that forehand. Too short.
And then it's Ferrer.
Well, he let Ferrer off the hook here. Second serve, and he just hits that in the middle of the court. Too short. You can't do that to a guy with a forehand like Ferrer's. There's that generation of pace I talked about. That ball was just soft in the middle of the court. He had to generate all his own pace and did it easily.
Long opening game. One love, Ferrer.
First game. Seven's Australian Open telecast, made possible by Kia's 5-year unlimited kilometre warranty. Medibank Private, I feel better now. And Bunnings Warehouse, where lowest prices are just the beginning.
You said Marcus is starting to ooze some confidence. Well, he's had so many good results here in Australia. He was Australian Open junior champion 2 years before he made the final here back a couple of years ago, and then last week winning in Sydney.
Marcus
epic match with Leighton Hewitt a couple of years ago that went to 4 o'clock in the morning. So a lot of his success in this game has been in this country.
Were all those relatives here as well in Australia?
Yeah, nine uncles and 20-odd cousins. And they're probably all here today, one would imagine.
Mm.
his aunties.
15.
He makes Ferrer do a lot of work in this point, which he's capable and quite happy to do. Ferrer, that's the way he plays. He can go all day, but doing some physical work in that point, and that might be a trend. That's what he bases his game around, Ferrer. Fit and strong. So it's going to be the flair and the variety of the Cypriot against just the solid doggedness of Ferrer. Sort of a good matchup. You get the human backboard there from Ferrer, and it gives Baghdatis a chance to show us his wares. But he's going to have to be good over a long period of time to beat the Spanish 27-year-old.
Just a wonderful preparation on the forehand. You can see the racket back so early, the feet moving underneath, and when you do that, you've got the ability to hold the ball or wait on the ball just a touch long enough for the opponent to commit, and then you can hit into the open court.
So as you'd expect, though, Ferrer plays very similarly to a lot of the European clay courts, where he will back away a lot, use his forehand. And if the right ball's there, don't hold your breath. He'll go after it. But he also bases his game around that strong aerobic capacity, that the ability to last out here a long time and get a lot of balls back as well. You sort of know what you're going to get, don't you, from Ferrer. He's ranked 18 now. He's been a top 10 player. He's been in the Masters Cup. He's a world-class player, but you sort of know what he's going to bring to the table each day. You have to be ready for a real mental battle. Baghdatis, you're not quite so sure. He can show some variety.
Baghdatis holds one all.
Attention, please. While Courtney Cox gives you some stretching tips, Courtney will be recovering in Seven's new Cougar Town. Time after the tennis.
Gee, where's JA when you need him?
Oh, dear.
So there'll just be a few more loose errors, probably, from this man. You'll see some spectacular stuff over the course of the match. But gee, a major part of winning is keeping those easy, unforced errors to a minimum.
that's how hard you have to work to win a point from David Ferrer. And Baghdatis still didn't win it.
31.
Good court coverage, though, from Marcus. Wonderful stuff.
Big physical effort so early in the match. That'll take a little bit out of him. It's only one all, 10 minutes in, but points like that hurt.
Ferrer, Shunjun, call on the right near sideline, the ball is called out.
You would think he'll have a good chance of it being on the line, but it looked like it was wide. Dead corrected. 1 millimetre it's in by.
Gee, your eyesight's gone early in your life.
Good challenge. 40 love. One millimetre. I'm just trying to... That's a... A little bit of the ball here, you imagine. Amazing.
Okay, Ferrer.
We're on serve. First set, 2-1. Ferrer leaving.
Ferrer leaves.
The umpire just asking... the crowd to take their seats quickly, really piling in here, the Hisense Arena. Biggest crowd in the history of the Australian Open during the day yesterday, so crowds are really supporting the event well, as you would expect. Good conditions today for another attack of that record, currently 21 degrees with a max of 28, so good tennis and viewing conditions. Tennis from the Cipriani levels at 2-2 in the opening set.
In round one, Leighton Hewitt was devastating. In his 14th Australian Open, Hewitt is back on Rod Laver Arena, taking on the man who won the Oz Open Juniors in 2005 as a 15-year-old, American Donald Young. It's Hewitt versus Young on day four of the Open.
That'll be an interesting match. The winner of that match to take on the winner of this one here. There were big... There was big talk about Donald Young, about being the next huge star in the men's game. And he saw he won the Australian Open at 15. And it's been a struggle for him to really get going. This is actually a good result for him to reach the second round by all of his other performances.
Gee, what a drop shot.
Yeah, you can't underestimate the talent of Baghdatis. This became a little bit awkward. So he's got to control the underspin on this shot, the width of it. He's got to be inside that sideline, obviously, and over the high part of the net and beat Ferrer. Beautiful touch. Makes a mess of something, Ferrer, that you would expect him to make. You know, that was a pretty simple shot, but he's so good at doing all of the basics well. He just keeps the pressure on your opponent all the time. Gee, it was a good game from Baghdatis, though. Big chance now. And this is a game of you get the highest reward from going closest to the lines in tennis. Sometimes it's a fine line, isn't it? But if you can get that ball just inside the line, you've got a much bigger chance of winning points.
Himself out of trouble. He doesn't serve massive in terms of speed. I mean, he's still at 184, but there's not much more he can get out of the serve, but it's the placement, and he sets up those easy mid-court balls that, as you just said, he just puts them away with ease there. It's just a 1-2 punch. Survives break point, but good, we're still on serve. 3-2. Beautiful day here in Melbourne. City skyline for Phillip Bay. Enough breeze out there to go for a sail.
Yeah, it's a great city, isn't it? You know what worries me a little bit about Baghdatis here, though, is he played a really good game. He played three or four excellent, talented points in the last game, but he still didn't win it. Ferrer held him off on his own serve, and that's a bit of a worry for Baghdatis. He's going to have to play to a very high level with his style against this type of player.
Umpire Jake Garner.
I think maybe wide here. Yeah, we're sitting on that line.
Second.
We're a fair way away from that line, but we're right on top of it.
Yeah.
See,
Baghdatis
there took a risk by that hitting that backhand so close to the line, down the line. That's a tough shot, low percentage shot, but it still didn't win him the point. You know, Ferrer, on the other hand, will play safer in the court so as not to make as many errors, unforced errors. Then when he gets the right ball, he'll crush it.
Crushed that one. 205 Ks right down the tee.
Well, he's got a sneaky big serve.
30-15.
Close to 6 feet tall in the old language, Baghdatis. He doesn't really appear that running around the court with his speed, but he's got a sneaky big first serve.
Solid game for Baghdatis, 3-all. Let's go back to school and have a look at a shot that I think this man hits particularly well. During this rally, you'll see him set up for a forehand. Looks like a normal shot, then he just comes underneath it and plays the drop shot. And that's a skill he has to try to break up the play. And in isolation here, you can see there, looks like it's going to be a full drive. Slight change of the grip. Racket head just comes underneath the ball to impart some spin. And that's variety, and that's what you need at this sort of level of play to be able to break up your opponent, break up a match. And Marcus uses that particular shot very well. We'll see it again throughout this match today.
Some money after that lesson. No wonder Peter Luchak's playing well.
It's easy to talk about it. It's just a bit harder to actually do it. Man does it well. It's a shot that I didn't really have in a repertoire.
Well, look, he's got a lot of talent, a lot of great feel in his hand. Baghdatis, he's one of those talented blokes.
There it is again. There's the case in point from Marcus Baghdatis.
And you've got to have great peripheral vision here too. He knows how deep Ferrer is in the court. He's inside the baseline to cut down the distance he has to hit that drop shot. It reduces the time that Ferrer will have to run it down. Perfect shot selection.
Oh.
must admit I expected Ferrer to make this. Not the easiest volley, but one you'd expect him to make. He had plenty of time.
Well, he wasn't under extreme pressure from where Baghdatis was in the court, but it was the skill level. It was off the shoelace, but he only had to get it over, and the point was done. It's juice now. Third time he's been taken to juice already in the set.
Well, that's not usual. Out of character. It's a sign of a little bit of pressure starting to mount on Ferrer. He normally hits that forehand in his sleep. Baghdatis applying the pressure here with a break point.
Unlucky two ways in that rally. The last forehand from Ferrer was a slight mishit and got enough of it to be able to shank it and just drop in. And then Baghdatis gets it into the tape. It had a look but didn't want to go over.
Well, you know, we talked about this two games ago. Baghdatis, for the second time in a row, is playing an outstanding game returning serve. He gets in a position where he's got a chance to break, but he just then throws in an uncalled for error at the wrong time.
This is also a sign of how confident Baghdatis is. You know, to change the direction, it's coming across court here. To change that direction, hit it over the high part of the net, so close to the line, takes not only a lot of skill, but some confidence as well. That's where you can derive a lot of winners, if you're prepared to take that risk. But it's where you might make the most errors as well. Walking that fine line. Wow, of the highest quality.
Advantage, Baghdatis.
Baghdatis again, getting the winner down the line, this time off the forehand wing. There's the versatility. He's working over Ferrer's forehand, but that opens up the gap down the line. You're going to be tired boys if they play five sets of this.
That's what he does well.
Isn't it funny? Baghdatis wins a lot of the spectacular points. Ferrer wins the unspectacular point.
Well, that's why he's been ranked so high for so long, is that his level of play doesn't alter. And under pressure, he plays the same strong points. And when players are not on their game, he beats them comfortably.
That's for sure.
Survives two break points, David Ferrer, and it's on serve, 4-3, opening set. Pressure mounting a little on Marcus Baghdatis. He's had three break points, two in that last game. Hasn't been able to capitalise. Serving with new balls. Over the last 2.5 weeks that we've been covering the Australian Open series leading into the Australian Open, gee, there have been an awful lot of breaks of serve around this game when the new balls have come into play.
15 on.
Such a discrepancy for whatever reason between the ball now, which is quite tightly packed and fresh, and then after a game or two it really fuzzes up and becomes much slower. So the guys here go to play the same shot that they played the previous game and it just flies off their racket, and you see a couple more unforced errors. He's doing a good job absorbing some of the pressure that I mentioned, because he's had the chances, but he's been holding serve comfortably.
It's always a bit of a worry too. The player with the flair can quite often be the player who puts in that bad game at times too and misses three or four easy ones. He's been able to avoid that so far, Baghdatis, so he's right there. He has a chance in this set, obviously. Serving well too.
For all. This is what's coming up next. Sam Stosur, number 13 seed, up against Germany's Barrar. And I think Sam in with a good chance in that one. So they'll be out there supporting it. Plenty of
here come the Cypriots
and Greek fans out here to support Marcus. He brings them in. He's a crowd favourite.
He's great for the sport.
Trying to do here, Fitzy, is that he knows that Ferrer likes to sort of get into the backhand corner and use the forehand and dominate from that portion of the court. So he's putting him into an area of the court that's his least favourite. And then when he drops it short, bang, he's opening up the line with the backhand. So very deliberate. A lot of the a lot of the Europeans, a lot of the clay courts like to stand right where he's serving now and dictate the rally from that portion of the court.
Yeah, look, it's a fine line, but he just chooses
59.
I think he just chooses the wrong time here to hit the drop shot. Ferrer was out of court. He's moving forward. He had his momentum moving forward. He was there easily, almost at the top of the bounce. Probably a forehand down the line and cover the net might have been a better option in retrospect. Easy when you're sitting up here and you down there, you have a split second of a time frame to make that decision.
They didn't hit it perfectly. He didn't mean to cut it that fine.
Gee, good challenge.
6 mil.
15.
Yet again, break points for Baghdatis.
Well, this appears to be his best opportunity, two in a row here. This would be at the right time for Baghdatis to break.
It was actually wasn't the greatest of drop shots, but what he did correctly here is he closed out that line and he forced that ball into the net. Baghdatis had committed himself to the shot and then realised he didn't have a lot of room. Just needed to flick cross court, but he hadn't sensed that Ferrer would cover the line so well.
There made a decision early, Baghdatis, that was the risk he needed to take. He just didn't get balanced. Thirteen unforced errors each, neck and neck. Is the case, this will be a psychological blow one way or the other.
the end of this first set. And the difference was the balance. And on the break point, Baghdatis didn't get set like he does here. Beautiful balance there. See the extra dimension from David Ferrer too, and he needs that to beat a quality player like Baghdatis. Can't just rally from the back of the court. You need to find different ways to finish points. You know, the really good clay courters probably have 6 or 7 different ways they can finish points. They can chip and charge sometimes. They can crack the first return. They can out rally. They drop shot. They sneak in. You need to be multi-dimensional. Does it again.
It is in. Saves break points for the third time and stays ahead 5-4. Don't know if Beck would like that.
Love the team.
Okay, now here's the trouble moment. He's had break points in the last 3 service games of David Ferrer, and now all of a sudden it's 5-4 and love 15. Pressure turns completely the other end of the court.
He doesn't overplay it. He just uses the angle. Hits it short and angled out wide to take Ferrer out of court. And a good player will know when to follow that in. Creating some angle himself, Ferrer the other way.
This is a big point here.
Hey!
Set point for Ferrer. Hasn't had a single opportunity on the Baghdatis serve until now. Hasn't even gone close. He's got it. He only needed the one chance. Not quite, perhaps. There's a challenge coming. No, it was well long. So it is. David Ferrer takes the first set in 53 minutes, 6-4.
6-4. The 17th seed from Spain, Ferrer, has taken the first 6-4. And it's one love in the second. Back to our commentators, John Fitzgerald and Todd Woodbridge.
Comfortable hold of serve in the opening game.
Good enough.
For David Ferrer. And gee, did a good job in that opening set of absorbing everything that was thrown at him by Marcus Baghdatis. He saved 5 break points. 4 of his service games went to deuce. He only needed that one opportunity when it got to 5-4. And that's the advantage, isn't it, of serving first in a set. When you get to the latter stages, you can build pressure at 5-4 or 6-5.
I think it just shows, it's the case in point where Ferrer is not the spectacular player, but he's ahead on the scoreboard. You've seen all the really wonderfully entertaining stuff from Baghdatis. That's why Ferrer is so hard to beat. This style of player is hard to beat. Careful here, Marcus.
I love the story about David Ferrer, because back in 99 he was struggling with motivation about, you know, his tennis and so forth, so he went and took a job as a construction worker. That lasted a week. There's that drop shot off the forehand.
Well, he needs to be able to finish points in a few different ways, Baghdatis. Good choice, because he was so close, so far inside the court, halfway to the service line. So perfect spot to try that shot.
The challenge, yes. You know, just that little dose of reality for David Ferrer at a young age really made it worth him pursuing his career. He knew what he was better at. What?
Juice.
15 millimetres wide, that one.
Baghdatis has 2 challenges remaining.
Prides a lot of his discipline and work ethic on that little expose a little construction.
A little stint into the real world.
Yep.
Be thankful.
Gets himself out of trouble.
One game.
There he is. There he is, Rusty. Wonderful player he's been over the years. He's got a big one today against Donald Young. He'll start heavy favourite in that match. Young, look, a talented player, not big in stature, not really that heavy off the ground, but he's a talent, a left-hander. He's got a lot of touch, feel.
Just quickly back to David Ferrer for a minute. This is another interesting one. I don't know if we could do this nowadays in coaching, but his coach, who he still works with, Javier Piles, he, when he failed to apply himself in practice sessions, used to lock him up in the ball shed at the tennis club. And until David decided that he was ready to get out there and have the right attitude and work properly, he left him locked in there.
Gee, he looks like such a nice guy too.
There he is.
Albert Costa sitting behind him. Davis Cup captain from Spain, former French Open champion.
Beaten in Davis Cup last year. Spain the champions, of course.
It's a fine line, this game, sometimes. You know, this ball hits the tape and could easily have just sat up nicely for Baghdatis to put a ball away. Oh, gee, a breakdown there mentally. Gee, that was one of the worst shots I've ever seen David Ferrer play. Just froze. Must have changed his mind halfway through it, and the execution was way off the mark. For me is that this ball's in, and this is the best shot we've seen all day, if it is. He catches the line. Gee, what a pass. Bad drop shot. Ferrer hit the previous point. Will that haunt him?
Gets the break this time. It's taken a while. Baghdatis goes ahead 2-1 in the second set. Sporting precinct. We're in High Sense Arena today. Marcus Baghdatis dropped the first, but serving with a break at 2-1.
Love for Jimmy.
And 5 break points in the first set. Wasn't able to capitalise, and at last he's got the break now. To play a solid service game to capitalise on it.
Love 30.
Quickly back, love 40.
Need a bit of that, guys. Well, what control on the half volley there.
It's in 40.
Would be a bit of a blow to Baghdatis to lose his serve, lose the break. It would stop that bit of momentum he had and make him get back to square one to fight hard again. Tough mentally.
Straight back for a 2-all.
New balls, please. Mike and Chin rules after the tennis on 7.
State versus state, plate versus plate. And Fitzy, thank goodness you're not cooking.
Well, yeah, no, my skills I wouldn't write home about in the kitchen, but...
I wouldn't write home about them either. I've tasted them.
Well, yours are pretty good, though, I might add. You can...
I enjoy it.
Maybe you can go on that one day. Bad drop shot there. So, will he drop off the pace of Fraxton? That's the worry. Look, he's done so well so far, Baghdatis. He's played a lot of wonderful, exciting stuff, but if he starts playing shots like that, loses a bit of concentration, he can be in a hole very quickly. So, Ferrer, the solidity of his game starting to shine through a little bit here.
Pretty 14-15.
He's a grinder. Ferrer will be here for hours playing at this level, rarely dipping below.
Ferrer holds, leads by a set and 3-2.
Ferrer leads.
Marcus Baghdatis, his level of intensity, concentration's just waning here. He got the break. He worked so hard to finally break after dropping the first set and having all of the chances in that set. And I think really he has to try to get back up a level quickly here, or he could see himself down 2 sets to love.
Good to know.
Sense a dangerous part of the match here.
I also think this is where physically, after having such a good week last week, which you want to be in good form, you want to play well, but 5 strong matches up in Sydney, and then your turnaround is very short coming into best of 5 set matches. Big forehand.
She needed that.
30-0.
I think that's a trade-off, though. You know, like, yes, he might celebrate for a day, or certainly in the way he feels anyway, he'd be feeling really good about himself. But I think what makes up for that physical effort and exertion up in Sydney is the fact that he is confident now. So, look, it's a bit of a trade-off.
David Ferrer, on the other hand, went to Auckland and lost in the opening match, so he's fresh as could be.
Well, he's fresh physically, but you know, he wouldn't quite have the confidence, although for his style of play, you know, you always know he's going to play to a pretty good base level. Baghdatis, though, there's more spikes in his form.
Does well. Three all.
He gave us a skip.
Big day for the Aussies on Rod Laver Arena. Coming up later this afternoon, we've got Sam Stoza and Leighton Hewitt. And, of course, tonight you just saw we've got Casey De Lacroix after the Federer match. So, opportunities for all of our players to do well. Marcus Baghdatis, change of racket, hoping for a change of fortune. New balls.
Yeah.
Best though, he plays some great stuff, doesn't he, Marcus?
15-0.
These are the types of points he has to be able to bring out of himself to win. What a forehand up the line that was.
Safe point from Baghdatis there. Went for nothing. Kept the ball straight up through the centre of the court. He's been the aggressive player the previous point, setting up the good net play. And he's at the end right now where you can be more aggressive too. Slightly downwind. You can get into net and the sun's no issue. If the lob goes up, you can see the other end this time of day becomes difficult, particularly now serving.
And first serve. Baghdatis is challenging the call on the 11-yard sideline. The ball's called in.
Interesting time to challenge here. Yeah, he knew he was right on that line. Tough for Jake Garner to see that one. Right under his nose. Good play though from Ferrer. Yeah, interesting that call from Jake Garner.
40-30.
I think because it landed so close to the net, the angle became a bit unusual. If it was further down that sideline, it's probably his easiest line to see, but there's the trouble with the sun. The practice ball toss. There is an issue there. Gee, Ferrer did well there.
Ferrer holds. It's on serve in the second. 4-3.
Denver.
Baghdatis serving, 4-3. Set to David Ferrer.
Too good. Good speed. Well, this is what's exciting about having Marcus Baghdatis on the court. Different style of play to most of the guys out there. And he always shows us a lot of flair. A lot of versatility in his shot selection. In the sun a couple of games ago, and no doubt it's having an effect on it did on Ferrer in the previous game. And Marcus there just I think struggling to gain to regain focus after having to look into the sun for that serve.
Impressive here. As soon as he makes this shot, he's off and going. You can see he's all set, ready to take off. Baghdatis in trouble. 15-30.
He really is in trouble here. As well as he's played, losing a little bit of the grip. Bad drop shot.
Well, he's on or just behind the baseline there. When he plays the good ones, he's usually a meter or so inside. Double break point. David Ferrer. Stood well back there to take that second serve. Wasn't aggressive in trying to dominate the point from the first hit, trying to set the ball up.
That's the clay quarter in him. But a mighty big couple of points, the last one and then again here.
He gets the break for out. He'll serve for the set here. And talking about that return of serve, just have a look here. This is where David Ferrer likes to take from. The yellow dot's the first serve, but you can see the black dot on the second serve, the forehand court. He makes a distinct decision that he's either going to go deep and hit a high ball and get himself in the rally, or get up and be aggressive. We saw he didn't do that when he had the break point. By comparison, up the other end, Marcus Baghdatis, he's more of a hard court player, and he likes to return up close to the baseline for the first and then inside it for the second. So two distinct types of players that like to play on different surfaces.
I'm fascinated by the black dot on the first court when Ferrer's serving. A lot of those second serves are way back behind the base because he's running around his back end to hit a forehand on that first court. And right there was where Baghdatis stepped inside the court, and you saw that on his strike positions. Likes to attack, and he is the hard court player here. They will play up further in the court than the traditional European clay quarter. But if you learn your tennis on clay, you know, you have the capacity to develop a game that has all the assets to make you so hard to beat over long matches. You're so solid in most facets of the game. You don't make mistakes. And you can go all day with the leg strength and the aerobic capacity. Gee, Ferrer and these types of players are hard to beat. was debatable there. David Ferrer got out there, hit the forehand, and fluffed it into the net, then challenged. I'm not sure Jake Garner, I think it was line ball there, whether he should have allowed him to actually make that challenge. He's right too, but that was a late challenge.
30-15.
So he sort of had his cake and he ate it as well at that point. A bit too anxious, Marcus, to come in.
40-30.
You come in across court to the forehand and you can get into trouble very easily because Ferrer was there with plenty of time to swing at the forehand. He was just over anxious to get in there early.
Set point now for a 2-set-to-love lead for David Ferrer, number 17th seed. And he has it. Ferrer takes a 2-set to lead. 6-4, 6-3.
And Medlucci challenging the call. Right near sideline. Ball was called out.
No, I was there for sure, 100%. Oh my God, Fergus, you think I'm just going to take my racket back? I could have gotten there easy. Well, I'm already there, yeah. If they don't make the call.
This Australian Open update is brought to you by ANZ.
Time to check in on Rod Laver Arena, where order has been restored in the match between Novak Djokovic and Marco Ciudinelli. Ciudinelli took the first set here against the number 3 seed and 2008 champion, but I tell you that Novak has really put the hammer down now. He has taken the second set 6-1. He was in a bit of trouble early, but has managed to wear down his Swiss opponent and claim it in just 40 minutes. He's pumped and he's back. And he leads now 2-love in the third set as well. So Novak Djokovic looking good. And I can tell you he's just taken another game in the third set. So
second set. Djokovic
now leads 3-love in the third. Big day for the Aussies ahead. Don't forget, Sam Stosur is not too far away, the number 13th seed. Conditions here absolutely perfect. And Leighton Hewitt will follow Sam on centre court. As we go back to Hisense Arena, David Ferrer, the 17th seed, has a 2-set lead over Marcus Baghdatis on serve in the third set. So Ferrer to serve, leading 30-love. Back to Fitzy and Todd.
A tough ask now for Marcus to get back in to this match. Down 2 sets to love. He's only come back from a 2-set deficit once in his career.
Well,
go for
it. You know, the added problem is that he's playing just a rock solid opponent who's not going anywhere and will maintain his level.
Well, kind of that racket hit a rock. This was in the changeover after he dropped the second set, and that new one hit one too.
Gee, that would have been something you would have been proud of in the old days, Todd.
I didn't do anything like that, Fitzy. I hope he's got a few more in there.
Gee, you'd be feeling hard done by a few of the racket inside the plastic bag. No reason to break that one. Yeah. Boy, it's so hard to win points.
This is where the frustration comes from, because he's played very good tennis today, and this man has given up nothing. And it's been Baghdatis who actually has had more break points. The opening set, he had 5, couldn't capitalise. Ferrer got 1 at 5-4 and broke. This is the end that Baghdatis has struggled from on serve. Dropped serve down there twice in the second set. He had an early break, broke for 2-1, and then lost his serve to 15. And then again, he dropped it to go down 5-3. So struggling, looking into the sun. Player's been on court just over an hour and 3/4.
Desperately, doesn't he, Ferrer? He doesn't want this to go past the third set now. Now that he's got the second set up his sleeve.
Well, I think mentally he knows that this is a moment. If he could get 2 sets and a break, it's hard for someone to get back. Baghdatis holds on. It's on serve in the third. 2-1.
Baghdatis.
Team. The court position of both players has just changed slightly. It was Baghdatis, the first half of this match was the one up in the baseline, really directing the traffic, and Ferrer happy to defend, if you like. But now he's the one that's sort of standing up, and Baghdatis is trying to find some space. And the only way he can do it right now is to go a bit early in the rally, like the last one, where he's done the drop shot. And then, of course, you bring the player into the net, and you've got to come up with something special on the pass.
He set up the points well with their serve today. All in the placement, deep into the corners, gets a mid-court reply and then puts the forehand away.
Hardly serves any aces for Ferrer. He's had one for the match, but you're right, he sets it up. It's an accurate serve, not overly big. That one only at 175.
It's 71% of first serves in play.
If you get it near the line, you quite often get that short reply. That's where he works his points from. Good depth. 30 in there, Baghdatis. He can't make a stand here early in the third, then he'll be history.
Infantino, Baghdatis' coach, sitting there, and he'll be trying to get him going, but he's got a long way to go.
Had a joke with Eduardo inside Rod Laver Arena the other day. Said he was the coach of the year so far, winning in Sydney. He thought that was pretty good. He's been around a long time, Eduardo.
Well, not the play you would expect to see from Ferrer too often, the chip approach shot, but he was forced into it by the short play from Baghdatis, and not bad, because this matchup for Baghdatis is not too bad. It's not Ferrer's strength to be in there, and if he gets set to hit a passing shot, you'd give him a good chance to win his percentage of points from that position. If you play Ferrer from the back of the court all the time, you're playing Ferrer at his strength. Need to take him out of that zone a little bit if you can.
Here's a chance.
Advantage, Baghdatis.
The break points, only able to take one of seven. By comparison, Dave Ferrer's made three of five.
The problem if you drop volley to the forehand side, you better get it right, and that's the execution of that is not that bad, but because of the hard court, the ball's always going to bounce up high. Ferrer gets there on the forehand side and he's able to swing at that ball rather than chip it from the backhand side. So
I think also what you can note with Ferrer is that as an athlete and a mover, he can move well in all directions. Some players good laterally, don't come forward, but he's got them both.
Spectacular. And is that an inkling of a smile? Well, Ferrer makes a similar mistake, really, to what Baghdatis did in the previous point. Both not bad drop shots in terms of execution, but you know, on this surface, it's always dangerous. The ball's going to bounce high.
Saves break points to level just after the tennis. A couple of new stars in the lineup for us there, Matthew Richardson and Tom Harley.
Gotta love those good South Aussie boys. Tom Harley, arisen from SA, and Richo, of course, great additions. That's a bad drop shot there. A bad one. You know, if you're going to hit the drop shot, try to have the opposition player with his body weight leaning backwards. If his body weight's leaning forwards, he's already got a jump start on getting to the drop shot. So he was already moving forward for air there. He's getting a bit desperate here, Baghdatis.
Yeah. Well, he's not penetrating. Great forehand there down the line, and the movement of Ferrer to get there, get the ball back into play, it's just basically driving him nuts.
Yeah, and the good old-fashioned fence post that David Ferrer has his legs, they'll carry him around this court for hours yet. And Baghdatis running out of ideas, can't finish points, looking for new innovation. Yeah, that's his best chance. Try to get the short ball and then rip the forehand. Aces himself, Marcus Baghdatis. Only 5 for the match, none in this current set.
No, well, I was talking about the balls earlier. Once they get that little bit heavier after a couple of games, they're harder to get away. All through the summer so far, we haven't seen as many aces served.
Clever volley. There's some class there. 40. Good technique on the volley here. Made to play a good old-fashioned punch volley into the open court. Beautiful.
Good person.
Good escape from Baghdatis. It's on serve in the third. 3-2. This third set following a similar pattern to the first two. It's David Ferrer serving. It's up two sets. 2-3.
Detect a slight limp in Ferrer's gait there.
Well, that was a little unusual. It wasn't a huge long point, and they'd just come out of the break, and then to take so much time, go back into the shadow, full towel off.
Well, he was certainly all right in that point, Ferrer, but he looked like he was almost hobbling after that first point, whether it was just a moment where he consciously felt the tiredness starting to seep into his system. I'm not sure, but he's taking a long time.
Been on court 2 hours and 7 minutes.
Oh. That's a waste.
30.
He's done that a few times, Baghdatis. From that first court, the serve into the body, he's tried to hit the off return to catch Ferrer on by surprise. Ferrer will serve and back away to his left. That's why Baghdatis is trying to hit the off return to catch him. But got to get into play or it's a complete waste. Feeling worse for wear a few points ago physically. Ferrer, he's rebounded very quickly, back on track now.
This is coming up next. Sam Stoser, the Aussie, up against Barra of Germany. Good opening round for Sam. And then that, of course, will also be followed by Leighton Hewitt. He's up against Donald Young later this afternoon. So plenty of exciting tennis and plenty of Aussies in action for you to watch too.
As it so often is with Ferrer and a lot of his compatriots who learn their skills on clay, they really make it a war of attrition quite often. If they can't win quickly, then you've got to beat them over long periods of time. And turn it into a physical battle.
I think that's tennis in general now, Fitzy, the physical battle. It's quite relative in the rankings when you see that the highest ranked teenager coming into the Australian Open was 170 in the world. And when you take that into account, and that's got a lot to do with being at your best at 20 in the early 20s. Oh, that's a freebie right there.
Yeah, that was a poor miss because at 15:30, 3 or 15:30, you know, this match is close to being over if he wins that point.
But the game played so strong from across the baseline and the guys being so big, the younger kids trying to break through are finding it tough. That one, the previous forehand, didn't matter.
Well, he's got a spring in his step at the moment for air because the finish line is in sight here.
Break point. And he's got it. David Ferrer leads by 2 sets to love and a break 4-3. Oh. 17th seed in complete control. 2 sets, a break of serve in the third. This part of the draw changed too, because David Ferrer was the seed that got moved into the place when Gilles Simon withdrew before the qualifying had finished.
Loved him.
And he was replaced, taken from one section in the bottom of the draw, and moved up into the top section of the draw. So he became one of the top 16 seeds.
Playing a loose game here by his standards, Ferrer. He only missed those first two forehands by a fraction, but 3 errors in one game. Unusual for him. Crowd starting to get behind Baghdatis. They want to see more.
15-40.
He needs the crowd to win this, Baghdatis, or to have a chance, though. He needs them to lift him.
Yahoo 7 is the official online broadcaster of the 2010 Australian Open. yahoo7.com.au/sport.
You're right. During the previous break, when the players were sitting down, the crowd were getting quite verbal in front of our commentary position, trying to get markers going. Amazing, isn't it? You mentioned the finish line, Fitzy, and as soon as, it doesn't matter who the player is, as soon as that finishing line comes up, the body tension changes, psychology changes. We haven't seen any of these loose errors from Ferrer in 2.5 sets. Now all of a sudden they're there.
I was thinking more in 2.5 years. His forehand has gone a little bit awry here, though. Well, he may as well let it hang out here, Marcus Baghdatis. He's got nowhere else to go. If he can't make a stand here, he's out of this year's Australian Open, so he needs to really buckle down. He's still in it.
Buckle down he does. It's 5-4 in the third. All the fans here at the Australian Open. Baghdatis' fans are getting vocal here in Hisense Arena. Really trying to lift their man. He's hanging in. He was down two sets, a break, a serve, but it's back on serve now. 5-4-2, David Ferrer. That poor Swedish bloke, I don't think there's anyone left from Sweden, is there?
Was that a Swedish accent? Was it my imagination that it was an Aussie accent? He's gone off the boil, though, hasn't he, Ferrer, here on Hisense? He's missing. Maybe he's just pressing, trying to finish it, going for a little bit more than normal, but certainly coming up with more unforced errors now. He's got to be careful.
Baghdatis is challenging the call. They got the far side.
I think it's wide. And he hit it pretty well. Good strike from Baghdatis, but just faded.
30-15.
That distance, Baghdatis, we're told, is 29 millimetres. So he's caught that one a fraction late. Now, he can steal this set here.
Well, that's what happened to him in the first.
30 on.
He was by far the best player, had all the chances, and it was Ferrer that did that to him. How ironic.
Problem for Ferrer here is that he's gone from a mentality of thinking, gee, I'm nearly there. I can be in, back in the cool of the locker room, to a couple of points away from being in a complete dogfight again. Oh, no.
40-30.
Ooh, that was a rush of blood in the wrong direction. Change of mind there from Baghdatis, surely, to cause him to hit such a poor slice. Gee, that's a good drop shot. And that's what I mean about having the player moving in the wrong direction. Ferrer had hit the serve. Or he'd hit that shot and then backed up further behind the baseline. So that's when Baghdatis chooses to drop shot, and it's the right time. There is a slight issue with his left leg, his left quad. Ferrer, as strong as he is, he's like a bull. But his leg's struggling a fraction. I reckon he's either cramping or he might have just strained a muscle here, Ferrer.
Yeah, I agree. That first serve on that point there, he really pulled up. No leg drive, and didn't land well. wide.
Stay tuned.
Well, he has a set point.
Do you think Baghdatis has realised? I bet he has. That his opponent's physically in a little bit of there's a problem here slightly, and he sees an opportunity now.
Set it up.
Where was the drop shot there?
He got the forehand. He had Ferrer on the run.
Was coming there.
Survives a set point, 5-all.
He gave us a...
Please.
Down two sets to love. If you sense a chink in the armour of your opponent, that really gives you an uplifting feeling where you think, gee, if I win this set, then he's got to play another full set at least to get me. And by then, he's not going to be any better.
Oh.
8-8. I'll start again. 8-8. No, I still haven't got an eighth ace. A bit of a tongue twister. Three for the set.
Ferrer isn't, even with some pain. They play with pain every day, as most professional athletes do, but he's not going to go anywhere. But deep down, he'll be hoping desperately to finish the match in this third set now. And he'll be ruining the opportunity he blew a few games ago, where he already had a break of serve under his belt.
Game for Baghdatis. It's 6-5 in the third. It's a bit of a battle going on here. David Ferrer, number 17 seed, two sets to love up, serving now to take this third set into a tiebreaker. The crowd doing everything they can to get Baghdatis into the match.
Yeah.
There's a momentum swing going on right now. A real change. We can only surmise whether it's an injury or whether it's tiredness. But David Ferrer, he's in trouble, although he's so far ahead. Love 30.
Well, he's not going to be in so far ahead in a few moments if he doesn't win this game. He's definitely got an issue at the end of the last game. He did limp slightly, not badly, not too visibly, but there's definitely a chink there, and it seems like he's strained the...
Well, so it's when he lands off the serve. He's moving okay through the rally.
Only affects him 5%. That can be the difference. And the problem is, if he does lose this set, it won't get better. That'd be a miracle if it got better. You'd think the only direction it could go would be worse. So Baghdatis would be clinging onto that thought. Of a few years ago when Baghdatis won so many of those long grinding matches. It's got the potential to build into something special here.
Set point.
This for a rally, and is David Ferrer tough? Yes, he is. And Baghdatis said, why push that one wide in retrospect? Gee, get it into the, inside the lines. What a way to save set point.
His nails, David Ferrer. He holds on. It'll be a tiebreaker.
Six games all, quick sets, tiebreaker. Both players receive one additional challenge.
Well, I wonder what he has to do, because it's been Marcus Baghdatis who's had the majority of chances. The first set in particular, had a break in the second. Two set points now here in the third. He finds himself down two sets to love in a tie break to stay in the Australian Open.
Seeing a lift in tempo here and an increase in shot making ability. Great angle. Well, those 2 points really lead you to believe that Baghdatis is here to stay. This might go the distance, if you want to make predictions. Three love, two mini breaks in this tiebreaker against an opponent who's questionably waning slightly. Just the thought, too, of playing in a memorable match, of coming back, a match that you'll remember always, that can be an inspiration. It gets the heart rate up a bit. Baghdatis is, he's experiencing that a little bit at the moment.
Gets one of those mini breaks back. You're right, he's only come back from two sets to love down once in his career, Marcus Baghdatis. After 6 points, and that's the evidence there of a player that is not a natural volleyer. When there was a bit of pressure on, it was still a pretty comfortable shot, but because of the scoreline and the situation, it becomes more difficult, and the feel was lacking.
Yeah, he hit that rod on the throat, didn't he? Just a breakdown of confidence, I think. Probably more than technique. He just overran that ball. Under pressure, not the shot he wants to play. He wants to hit the forehand.
5-1.
Great smash there, out of position. You need a lot of control on that racket head to
5-2.
To angle that one across court.
It's a nice little gift.
6-2, Baghdatis.
Had two set points. He's got four consecutive here. Gone.
6-4.
That was a clever chip down the line there from Baghdatis. Ferrer was leaning the other way across court for the regulation high percentage chip. He goes down the line. You could hear the exertion there from Ferrer trying to get back for that forehand, but he's showing a lot of guts at the moment. He's not going to lie down in this set yet.
In it. Ferrer leads by 2 sets to 1. David Ferrer serving. He leads by 2 sets to 1.
Lovely.
Well, this is sort of crucial moments here. The beginning of the fourth, David Ferrer, he had that chance to almost finish it off. Led 2 sets and 4-3. Took the break at 3-all. Then almost sort of limped into the tiebreaker. Baghdatis taking the momentum. The crowd, they're all behind him.
Not for sure.
But he's really got to try and impose himself, I think, quite early in this fourth set, Fitzy, just so that he can, you know, get the match back to square, back to even.
Oh.
Well, they're both good at that, aren't they?
It's
a different sort of shot than going with the off forehand. They're both really good at hooking the ball. It's almost like a draw shot with spin. Creates the angle.
There's one fella sitting in the locker room right now enjoying watching this match. It'll be Leighton Hewitt. He's on later this afternoon against Donald Young. And I think we'd all expect that he should get through that match. Nothing's for certain, obviously, in sport. But the winner of that takes on the winner of this. And the longer that this goes, the more that these two take out of each other, the better it is for Leighton.
But you saw Ferrer there try to re-establish his position. He hit the volley, started moving back into the middle of the court here. He went back to his right, and there was the gap. Good movement by Baghdatis to get there, and early preparation.
Game.
Yeah. And the turnaround may continue here.
This is one of the key highlights in the third set. And it was at this stage in the third set, it was early, that Baghdatis looked like he was almost done and dusted in this year's Australian Open.
And there's an argument to say that right now he's almost favourite in this match. He's still down two sets to one, but he does have a break. He's attained that in the first game of the fourth. Ferrer, is he starting to drag the chain even more as this match wears on? Baghdatis looking fresher.
Love the
sir. Well,
15.
Sometimes it's instinct when a player knows he has to pull the trigger. Just a quick realization that that was his best option. Inclined to get a few more free points, Baghdatis, and as the match wears on, that will become a factor. 30 all, there is nothing like the feeling that a free point off a first serve gives you. Ferrer really doesn't get many of those.
There's another one. Consolidates the break for two love.
Sevens Australian Open telecast made possible by ANZ. We live in your world. Golden Circle, made under the sun. And Optus, proudly supporting Australian tennis.
The 24-year-old Cypriot, he finds himself in good shape early on in the fourth set. It's amazing to think that he's only 24. He feels like he's been around forever. It's 2006 he made the Australian Open final. He was man of the year in Cyprus in 2005. Yeah, pretty young to be man of the year, but you know, one of the things that I guess we was lucky to get after that 2006 Australian Open final here was that he was given a 12-year exemption in military service for the Supreme Government.
Oh, two mistakes in a row. One from Ferrer that... That was a poor drop shot too.
It's compulsory there to spend a 26-month stint in the army, so he's got that exemption.
So you can hear Ferrer there talking to his camp. He's in trouble. That's his voice, and his coaching box is right behind his right shoulder.
Not for sure.
Well, we heard the let there in our... earphones. Ferrer asking Baghdatis, have you heard a net? Marcus saying, yeah, I heard it.
Nets.
It's always a worry when a player starts rabbiting to the box.
Forty-nine. Okay.
Ferrer gets on the scoreboard, but it's Baghdatis with the break early in the fourth.
Baghdatis leads 2 games.
Baghdatis serving. 15 love, ace to the first point. Starting to get a lot of free points now on the serve.
Makes a difference, doesn't it? His percentage is not as high as Ferrer, and you wouldn't expect it to be because the speed of Ferrer's first serve is less. But Baghdatis will get more free points, and that will make a difference. Especially in the fourth and fifth if we go that far.
Great back end down the line, setting up the easy winner. Very measured shot that was, Baghdatis. Look, that was a big point. Couldn't afford to make an error, but he was well balanced, in position, and really backed his ability there to lace that one down the line, and that was an easy put away. Drop shots have not had a huge winning percentage ratio, I wouldn't think. Quite often the guy who plays the drop shot is not winning the point.
Juice game. Baghdatis survives.
Baghdatis leads 3 games.
We'll take a look at some of the service direction here in the first set of Marcus Baghdatis.
Yeah, well, his percentage has improved gradually in this match today. 50% in the first, 56 in the second, and the direction probably getting better as well. The yellow dots are the first serve. He's up to 62% in the third set, and if that increases, he's going to be hard to beat. The direction on the first serve, very important. If he can get the ball close to the line, he's getting a lot of free points. Gee, there's a lot of effort in Ferrer's game.
That's what makes it hard, I think, for him to really go deep into these tournaments, because he has to play at a level
over five sets for a long sustained time. Rafa, Roger, you know, they get 30. 2 to 3 rounds that are really quick, and yeah. Then they might get one tough one, but they don't usually get one like this so early on in a tournament.
Yeah, I think it's an age-old contested issue. You know, if you have in the middle of the tournament 2 or 3 quick ones, then you can go. You can be fresh for the end of the second week. But very few players are good enough. Good angle again from Ferrer. Very few players are good enough to win matches easily in the middle of the tournament. Only the great players, so they get a bit of extra breathing space. They're fresh and their bodies recover. And by the time they get to the semi-finals, they're ready to go. If you have your first or second or even your third rounds at five sets, you're worn out by the time you get to the round of 16.
Marcus Baghdatis serving. Up a break, 3-2 in the fourth.
Well, there's the first serve coming into play again. The number of free points starting to increase. Result on the drop shot, and you wouldn't see Ferrer play as many of these under normal circumstances, I don't think. I firmly believe that his slightly lack of condition here, not in terms of a slight injury, is causing him to overplay the drop shot now. One of the fittest guys out there, David Ferrer, but that small niggle he has in the thigh, causing him some problems still.
40-11.
He's talking about the serve speed, Fitzy. I mean, the average serve speed between the two of these, so it is Ferrer at 175 and Marcus at 190. And that's the difference there. So that was a 200 three-point love game. 175. Grey's Anatomy back after the tennis. And that first episode of that will be an absolute ripper because we lose one of the main cast members, but we don't know which one it'll be. But just back to the serves. At 175, you're not getting a lot of free points. You've got to then hit the winner like you did there. It's a set-up serve.
Yeah. go so far as to say I can't remember the last time someone's won a point with a drop shot.
Now both of them.
I heard something, but I didn't know what it was.
And both of them just trying to get some quick, cheap points. Marcus is discussing with the linesman whether he said anything. Love game for 4-3. Baghdatis still with the break on serve, but down love 15 here, serving.
Flexibility there.
Jesus, might have taken skin off the knee.
Well, when you lose the point, it feels a stretch even more, I'm sure.
Both players taking longer than is allowed here in between point.
Becoming more important, isn't it? As time goes on, more and more. The first serve of Baghdatis.
That one over 200 again. 203. Psychology there. Wasn't a good serve, it was mediocre serve, but he knew the importance of being given the free point. Plant that seed of doubt into your opponent.
Yep. Serve keeping him ahead in the count in this set, Baghdatis.
He gave us a skip.
Baghdatis is challenging the call on the left service line. Ball was called.
Well, I think Ferrer there asking Baghdatis whether it was out, and Baghdatis was pretty confident, but he got that wrong by quite a margin, really. Yeah, and I think we'll see Baghdatis play this game just like that. I don't think we'll see a lot of grinding from him in this game if he can help it. Try to finish the points quickly. If he can snatch the break, all the better. If not, he should be a little fresher to hit a few bombs when he serves for the set next game.
Set points. Set points to level at two sets apiece. And we're going five. Baghdatis takes the fourth. Two sets all.
And now we've got this beauty as we rejoin Todd and Fitzy.
Baghdatis leading 40 love.
40 love.
In the opening game of the fifth set. This match today at 3 hours 32 minutes in length. First two sets, really a grind from both players. That fourth set in particular, though, the points really shortened. Games were much quicker. There's another love game for Baghdatis, opening game of the fifth. There's some highlights of that last set. There's Baghdatis really starting to work all of the court.
There was a slight drop in I think standard in this fourth set, though. Ferrer's gone off a little bit. Baghdatis made a few more unforced errors, but he did serve very well. Finished it strongly there. But now he's absolutely the favourite. The pendulum has swung.
Yeah, most definitely.
Thank you.
And that's what Ferrer needs. He needs a few more free points like that one on his first serve. Her serve percentage very good for him, 68% for the entire match, but not going for them.
30 down.
Last time Marcus Baghdatis played a five-setter here at the Australian Open, it was against Leighton Hewitt. And it was at a similar time. Then he went into the fifth set, somewhere around 3 o'clock. That one was AM.
Big moments, are they, aren't they? But you get to that 30-all stage of any game when it's getting deep into the match, and the pressure is on the server, no doubt.
Fire.
totally convinced about the technique there on the forehand volley. That was a bit of a scoop.
40-30.
And if that had been early in the first set, maybe Baghdatis could have reached this drop volley, but not early in the fifth. Oh, a little bit shaky there on the technique from Ferrer. He gets away with it.
So go ahead.
So both players now not moving quite as sprightly as they were in the first set, just a fraction slower. The drop shot works on this occasion. Good execution of the topspin lob.
Look at the career five-set record of these two. David Ferrer, 112 and lost four. Marcus Baghdatis, 19 and lost five.
Shaking his head there, but he'll be relieved. That was nothing if not a bit of luck. Dead let cord at juice.
Australian Open telecast made possible by Kia's 5-year unlimited kilometer warranty, Medibank Private, I Feel Better Now, and Bunnings Warehouse, where lowest prices are just the beginning.
This is for his eighth straight Australian Open, his best result coming back in 2008 when he reached the quarters. He lost to the eventual champion Novak Djokovic.
First step, you can see the physical change in these players getting close to 4 hours, 3 hours 40 at least. A lot of running, a lot of hard yakka out here, and that first step not quite as sprightly.
Couldn't be any closer. Total points won, 142 points each.
Good hustle from Ferrer.
15-30.
Gee, I thought Baghdatis had done enough to win this point. I really did. He got a bit lucky there with the one on the line. That was a good shot. Ferrer pushes himself physically, makes Baghdatis play the next ball.
You've got to go all the way back to the seventh game of the third set when Baghdatis was in this sort of position on serve. 15-30.
Oh, yes. The opportunist Ferrer here.
30-40.
A good move.
Well, he hasn't seen a lot of the second serve for a while, and then that one, the lack speed, allowed him the time to get around and use the forehand and be aggressive. Break point. And it was fleeting.
Juice.
Yeah, well, this is really good, courageous stuff, too, from Baghdatis. He's down the break point. He hit a very good serve, an excellent backhand up that line, which is the tougher shot, and casually knocked off the winner to save the break. First step there was good. Gets in, he sees the floating return. It's okay to hit this shot if you get the ball high enough above the ground, but if it drops too low, you can get yourself into trouble. Good high contact point there for Baghdatis. Back to Juice. A broken racket. That's out of character for Ferrer.
Advantage Baghdatis.
Can tell how much he wants to win this. He's just smashed his racket out of complete frustration. Yeah. Ooh, it's a nasty sound.
Well, both of them have had a go at it today. Marcus, after the second set, he demolished two.
I think you'd be proud of both of them.
Good effort. Just goes to show what it means.
Come on,
survives a couple of break points. Baghdatis 2-1 in the fifth. Well, this match is taking a physical toll on both competitors. Lucas Baghdatis receiving a bit of treatment. Top of the quad. Almost, it looks like where the hip flexor muscle is. And that just comes from overuse.
Well, they're pounding away for 3 3/4 hours now on a hard surface, covering a lot of court. Physical. Oh, gee, there's that drop shot again. It's like donating points. I think he changed his mind there. Baghdatis, I thought he might just push this down the line, but no. Donation. Down to attrition here. Here's the chance for Baghdatis now.
15-40.
No emotion at all here from Ferrer. He just gets on with business. Break points. Plays a lot of his best points, David Ferrer, when he's down. Break points down. Puts his head down, keeps cracking those ground strokes.
Using the forehand, sort of dominating out of the left portion of the court, the backhand side, that's where he's happy.
You know, psychologically there, you know, when Baghdatis has the break point, he plays the ball a little safely, not wanting to make the error, and his opponent ends up pulling the trigger first. You just get so frustrated, don't you, when you've lost the point, that's where we saw
him break a racket.
He's thinking, now, why didn't I pull the trigger earlier?
Ah!
He's a clean hitter of the ball.
Baghdatis
here. That one forehand down the line he hit before the last point was outstanding. That was a simple shot, the last one.
Third opportunity for the break this game.
I think he's breathing hard.
He's got it. Baghdatis takes the lead in the fifth.
Quiet, please. 15 love, 30 love, 40 love, and that's another fault. Sevens knew how I met your mother after the tennis.
All the great shows. Back on your screen after the tennis. Where? Tuned in to an enthralling match, though, here. Two sets all. Marcus Baghdatis with a break of serve now. 3-1 in the fifth.
Can I tell you what? An easy game here will go a long way.
15-9.
To giving Baghdatis a victory here. Out of screen, David Ferrer just coming to blows with one of the chairs, I think, on the other end. Yeah, not happy.
Well, controlling the court now.
30
serve's been a major part of the difference in the latter stages here. A good first serve gives him the opportunity to play that drop shot.
Easy love game. Baghdatis racing ahead 4-1 in the fifth. Oh, excellent point.
Well, they've both used that play. I think Baghdatis a little more often, but they've both used this play where they get their opponent wide and then go back behind him with even more angle.
His coach, Eduardo Infantino. Yeah.
Wonderful use of the chip. Great slicing there from Marcus Baghdatis.
15-30.
Well, here's one for the old guys. Two beautiful slice backhands into the corner. Oh, yeah. Nice touch. He's looking to finish this match here.
4 hours just passed on the...
Oh, I can't believe he hit the drop shot. And he can't either. Why? He had his racket ready. He played a ball on the baseline there. Oh, he could have done anything with his forehand.
Well, drive it into the corner and come forward into the net again. 30 all. 4 hours passed on the clock. I didn't finish the last sentence.
The flair there working against Baghdatis, you know. A more conventional player probably would have just gone for the odds, hit the forehand into the corner. The scoreboard, it looks like this might be over, but I think there's even an inkling of cramp in Baghdatis. Is there more drama to follow? He started walking back here and then really felt his legs. That's cramp.
Wow.
And you don't know how cramp's going to react. Oh, he's in trouble.
Oh. I've had this happen, and it's not pleasant.
David, just wait a second, okay?
Well, if he wants to get treatment here, he's got to concede the game and can sit down and have treatment, but he can't stop until the change of ends.
And he's trying to continue moving too, obviously. That's no new dance step.
It, he sees it. You can see the desperation in running for every shot in this rally.
And you know, before this game started, when Baghdatis was having his problems, Ferrer indicated to the umpire, we've got to get on with this. That's the competitive spirit in both these players. Ferrer's not going to let him get away with anything here.
The problem he faces, if he starts cramping in different parts of the body, you know, the leg goes, you try to straighten the leg out, then the stomach goes.
Well, one thing's for sure, he's going to go for the the cannon in the first serve to try to get the free point.
Well, he has to.
Getting a little emotional here too, Marcus. It's a Cyprus badge on his shirt there, and he's kissing it already. Oh, that's a great volley. Gee. Well read.
30-15.
He's doing exactly what he has to do here. He's got to kick the point short. You've got to be aggressive. Gets the short ball. Comes in the right angle. Definitely out, but it gives him more time, you see. He's using everything to his advantage. There you go.
30 on. Baghdatis has two challenges.
Has two left anyway.
Well, wasn't close. This just gives him time to regroup, loosen off if he can.
First double fault of the whole match. Can you believe that?
Chance to get one of the breaks back for Ferrer.
Ferrer here too.
Yes.
He wants to win just as badly as this man. What he wanted. He's been looking for that for about 4 or 5 points, Baghdatis. He finally gets the freebie.
Match point.
Turn from Ferrer under pressure.
That was a big serve out wide, 2-0-1.
This dramatic situation to pull off some amazing shots. That forehand was as good as it's been, as good as we've seen all match.
Match point number two.